My name is Joyat Devnath. I'm from Winona State University. And just to give you an idea where I'm from, and that's the Winona, that's where I'm. And these are just some of the pictures I always tell. Anywhere I'm presenting, I always tell them where I'm from. And that's like a spring and a summer. And that's the Mississippi River. And that's fall. And that's how the winter looks like. So the idea for this talk today is very, very brand new to me. What happened was I was talking to a couple of people from our high school, and they pointed out that they also do flipped classroom idea with IBL, and in their ninth grade in a humanities class. And it's kind of exciting, and they directed me to one of the blog that these two teachers wrote. If you are interested, you might want to copy it down. That's calgaryscienceschool.blogspot.com. And after I read that, I thought I might try that to my lower division class, and that's pre-calculus. So that's where all it started. This is my department. We have mathematics, math statistics, and math ed joint in one department. And we have about this kind of faculty composition, more math faculty and four math ed and six statistics. And we have some fixed term and adjunct. And we have about 100, 120 majors in the department. Several joint majors with math. And physics, engineering, computer science, even some psychology and music. And we consider this pre-calculus as one of our grooming ground to recruit more majors. You would think that why not it's discrete math or why not it's foundation of mathematics? Yes, they are, but pre-calculus also helps us students to get them ready to go with calculus. And eventually, maybe they will like and do it. This is my idea about Moore's philosophy that I really like to go on. And there are many others as you all practice this. But these are the two things that I think are very important. The student is taught the best who is told the least. And the other one is I hear, I forget, I see, I remember. When I do, I really understand. IBL and the Moore method to me appears to be a deductive manner of instruction that we used in advanced mathematics class. Now, I'm talking about in a lower division mathematics class, so keep in mind that. And the content of the course is usually presented in a whole or a part, but mostly by the students. And the students are given a lot of definitions and theorems, and they are asked to prove it. But in lower division class, we cannot give them theorems to prove, but you will see what I do. I try to give them identities and formulas, and then leave them to do the problem on their own. And then the trouble happens that it kind of limits how much material I can cover, but I have been successful somewhat, I would say. I tried only once last in spring. But it does help to have a better understanding. And at the end of the semester, when I asked them, it looked like a lot of students are going to go for calculus. So that was a nice thing. The next slide is about how I look at mathematics. So I went to another conference where people were brainstorming what is actually mathematics. What does our undergraduate student think about mathematics? And it's kind of nice. There were all kinds of definitions, but the way I look at it is a form of reasoning. And it should have a cumulative ideas, and the concept should build one up on the other. And then we also talked about in that conference that how do we think mathematically? What does it mean when we say I'm thinking mathematically? So to me, this consists of thinking in a logical manner, going with the ideas, making sense of complex structures, and seeing similarities and differences, and making judgment, making conclusions. So this is the way we define what is mathematical thinking. So I'm showing you these because these are part of my ideas that I want to instill in our students. And what do I say about demonstrating mathematical behavior? Math is hard, I cannot do them, oh, it is too difficult. Those are not mathematical behavior. So I talk about that with my students, that these are the behavior that I'm going to look in you. You need to understand what we are doing, what are the patterns, and what are the things that are connected with each other. What does it function when I say function and I say f of x, f parenthesis x, but we also say sine x or log x. Sometimes they think log as something that they can distribute, and that's something that is not something they should do. So these are the things. These are the kind of idea of my teaching practices. And so first is I try to student understand and they are able to explain and ask questions. So we can also check for their understanding. In the second phase, with this pre-calculus class, I have a big class. And I also have some teaching aids. They are basically math ed majors, but they want to have experience with teaching ideas. So I have a grant on which I can hire two work study math ed students, and they can help me in the class. So they attend the class, and they also help me with the study session. So I call them student instructors or student peers. And so sometimes when I'm lecturing, they are in the class. They get review when I'm lecturing, but they can also help the students. And then finally, the phase three, we always have to make sure that we are assessing our students' understanding. University requires that, and that's like either give tests or quizzes and things like that. So these are the benefits. So there are tons of stuff, but when I want to concentrate, I try to concentrate on these, that I'm teaching them problem-solving skills and they can think. Many times I tell my students, it's not that I'm teaching mathematics to you, I'm really teaching how to think. So that's one of my goals. I want to make sure that they can transfer the concepts. Like if I'm teaching exponential functions and they are in a biology class doing some kind of experiment, and they now know that I would like to know, so they take the swab and then they put under their feet and then they put and then they want to count how much it grew, so they can transfer their understanding on exponential functions. It teaches students how to learn. Sometimes students will come and say, I have studied for 6 hours and I don't know, when I come to the test, I cannot perform, I just get frozen. And so I feel like they need to learn how to learn. They need to understand how to take the concept and hold that concept. And also students get the ownership of their inquiry so they can ask questions. So with my class, I tell them, don't worry about raising your hand. If you have a question, interrupt me, I'm fine with that. I will always remember what I want to talk about. So keep on going. So these are some of the steps that I try to understand when I'm teaching. Mostly with this IBL method, understand where they're coming from. So I give them a handout. So what are the courses they have taken? Mainly I'm looking for if they have taken college algebra, either in my institution or in high school or somewhere else. So then I build on that, ask a lot of questions. And of course, they need to justify what they are doing. Now I'm taking you to my students in my pre-calculus course. So I try to make sure it takes about a week or so for them to open up so that they can start asking questions. And if they do not ask questions, then I tell them, if you are not asking questions, then it is my turn that I will ask questions. And so think about questions. Sometimes I assign them in the class that you have to ask at least 3 questions, and then I will collect them. So of course, word problems. and helping them to process the ideas, justifying answers so they know why this is a correct answer, what kind of answer is a correct answer, or is there any way where they get distracted with that answer and they can argue that why this is not a correct answer. Role of variables, this is one of the things very, very important. They will start doing the problem, they will not know what X stands for or what Y stands for, and then finally there will be an answer, and they get very upset because I take off points. I said, I don't know what X stands for, what do you mean? So explaining the variables, and when you are saying function of X, F is not a variable, X is a variable. So these are some of the things, developing problem situations that require applications. Of course, you all probably do that too. Now I'm going to take you about my idea or understanding about the flipped classrooms. So these are the 10 things that I found about the flipped classroom. And I have talked to many people. There are some people, they will never ever lecture because they are now so much bought into flipped classroom. I don't think I'm that far yet, but I probably understand few of these things. So the students will, in my class situation, I have some videotape, or if I don't have a good videotape for myself, I can use the Khan Academy videotapes, if you're familiar. And I also use a software, if you know, it's called Alex. Anybody familiar with that? Okay, so there are tons of different software, but Alex, I like it because I can control how many times they can try this homework assignment. I can also control what percentage of students they can do, and then they will get a progress assessment. And every 25% of the amount they learn, they get a progress assessment, and with that progress assessment, I can see whether they retain the information or not. Okay, so some of the good things are there, and I'm not advertising Alex, but it just works very well for me. So then that's what I assign them to do, or ask them to do, instead of being in class. And then when we get back to the class, we try to work on different things. So this is the model that they say is a good one that works. A lot of faculty, like I told you, are very much with the flipped classroom idea. The most important thing I like is the class time. Class time becomes really, really active. And even though I start with 70, 75 students or so, because I have two TAs, it really works for me because three of us can actually help students work and then answer their questions. So class time becomes, sometimes it becomes quite chaotic, and I have to sometimes say, okay, everybody has a question on this, and let's talk about this question now. But it's really active, and I like that. So like I said, it frees up time. A student learn more on doing and asking questions. Apparently, this is our syllabus that I have to teach. This is kind of standard syllabus. I just wanted to show it to you, basically. They all have a graphing calculator. Our university is a laptop university, so everybody has a laptop. And our internet connection is really good and strong. So students can actually go in Alex while they are with me in class. And I can go to Alex too. And I can even bring any student work and show on the class. So that's kind of nice. And with the Alex, they can also do some kind of networking and understanding. This is the Khan Academy, just a sample to show you how this is. And once you go to the Khan Academy, you can choose different parts, and I can assign them that this is the one that you are going to look and study tonight before the class tomorrow. Okay, so you get the idea of the flipped classroom, you get the idea of the IBL method. So here is a sample. I thought trigonometry sample will be a good one to show it to you, because before that, in upper division advanced math classes, you can talk about theorems and you can talk about definitions. In lower division math classes, what can I do? So I give them identities, for example, different formulas, and then ask them, that can you prove this? And we have a blackboard, a long class blackboard, and I split that into four or five sections. And then I will say, different students will be in different section. And I have put pictures in past in Facebook where my students are working IBL. They are working on each problem on one piece. And after they are done, we get the students to discuss whether they think it is a correct solution or not correct solution, or what can we change. So sometimes in class, per row, I will say that these four of you, you grade problem number one, and you guys do grade problem number two. And then I will have another row, they can be playing as judges. So they can decide whether whatever grade they give is a correct grade or not. So it becomes a really interesting, and it takes a lot of pressure from my side. The students hear from themselves, and they learn, I think, a lot better. This is another example of the word problems. You always invariably have to put a problem where two trains are going from two different directions. It's just like a interesting. And I started using some music problems, and so these are some of the other problems. Okay, so how did it work for me and my students? So first of all, I was really excited when I found this connection between IBL and the flipped classroom idea. I thought I will give it a try. First, I was not so sure how I can do it, and it felt like it will be a lot of work, but when the students learn and they talk and they, when the class ends and they, before they are leaving, they tell you, Joyari, I really like this. Are you going to do this every day? It just tells you, okay, something is really working here then. I tried to do whatever. Sometimes there will be some students who may be shy, will not be, never again want to come at the board, but other students can help them. Yes, you can do it. You know, go, you can do it. We can help you. So whatever I can use, I tried them. I also have some kind of award system, but I don't tell them that it's an award system. I buy like a Kit Kats bar or Twix bar, things like that. And if I feel like this student really presented really well, and I'll say, okay, here is a gift for you. So, and then they like it. So that's kind of thing. I used, also gave traditional exams and two periods long, and I graded them just like the way we always grade. On the homework problem, like I was telling you with the Alex, they get an unlimited, you know, to improve on. So how does it work is, once they get a problem, once they get a problem set, a homework set, they get a score instantly, as like in any software. But then they can figure out which problems are incorrect. Now, if they click it in there, now they will get another problem, not exactly the identical problem, but in a different way. But the content is still the same. So until they get all 20 problems correct, they can keep on practicing. So I give them a due date, but then I also tell them, okay, you have this much time, and this is the last time I'm going to upgrade your homework score. And they can even upgrade their homework score after the midterm exams. So I feel like students like that. Okay, so also in the Alex, you can make some kind of adjustment that how much you want them to learn. Like you can say that you want them to achieve 100%. So I used to do 80%, 70% by when I heard from other faculty members that it's difficult. I said, I'm going to, since I'm doing this idea of mixing these two methods, I'm going to make it 100%. Let's see how it goes. Okay, so this is what happened. So I had 70 students to begin with, 59 students ended. A few students dropped at the beginning because they realized they won't be able to do this. I'm not going to just fit them. They just think like, if you are my teacher, you're supposed to teach me and I'm going to just sit there. And I said, no, that's not how it's going to work this time. I'm going to try something new and let's see how it goes. So that's what happened. A few students also complained that it took them too long. And a few students didn't like the Alex software idea. 2 minutes. The Alex, because Alex, when they score, if when their assessment comes, this is progressive assessment. Progressive assessment is not part of any of their grade. They can lose, if they did it wrong, then they will lose what they have learned. So suppose on one topic they have learned 100% and now they got a progressive assessment and in that progressive assessment they got some problems incorrect, then that will take away some piece off from their pie. There is a big pie and it will take away. And some people didn't like it, but some people liked it. They complained they needed too much time. I told you about this. This is the eventual outcome. 17 students out of 59 completed 100%. That means they got a solid A. Okay, 11 out of 59. Okay, and 90% and above. 17 out of 59, B. And these are C and remaining that. 2 minutes. 2 minutes? 1 minute. Okay. So this is actually my last but one slide. I just think like this is a good idea, and if you ever want to try, I would really love to collaborate, and maybe we can work on some kind of article or something, and I think I will continue checking this out, and I'm going to try this again in fall. Thank you.
So based on your experience this time around, what's the first thing you'll change next time?
I'm not going to be not so strict on 100%. I think that raised some issues in the class. But then I also want them to learn it all. So I just want to say it, but maybe I'll be a little kind. I hate to carve. I just keep on telling them that, as you can see, I was not born and brought up here, and in the way we grew up, we never had any partial credit whatsoever. So that was one of my biggest cultural shock when I arrived in the United States. What is partial credit? So I'm still, after 30 years of staying in this country, I'm still struggling with this partial credit issue. And in every test, I have one line that I copy-paste saying, don't rely on partial credit to pass this course. You really have to work. So that's the only thing I felt. But then students who didn't really stay with me, I don't know if they would be ever wanting to learn mathematics. So we'll see how it goes. But the students who did stay, they all went to calculus. So that is a big thing. They never thought they would go to calculus. So that's the success that I'm happy about.
Mm-hmm. Other questions, comments? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.